This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Someone Shot My Book. Julie Carr. University of Michigan Press. Ann Arbor. Someone Shot My Book. It is the dilemma or double bind of undertaking to put the elusiveness of signification in touch with political responsiveness in shifting contexts of social suffering and affliction, political death and displacement, where life reaches its limit. Of course, it is the limit that creates the event of life that is the necessary condition for the experience of life. Athena, Athena, see you. In any case, a poem, a poet, is always an uncomfortable and threatening being who belongs equally to the chambers of the living and the dead. Choose Pato. 1. Bullet. Someone took my book out into the woods and shot it. The book is intimate with violence now in at least two ways, both as subject matter, violence is what it's about, and as target. The book reaches the gun as its interlocutor. Or, now the book with holes throughout needs to be written again. But when someone shot my book, I felt it got what it deserved, that it had met its precise right audience. And I felt the book had received its precise right author. The book had been re-authored, or finally authored, by the bullet. In aiming to silence life, the gun makes life more present, it makes available, quite literally brings to hand, the grief we are already feeling, the grief that one could call the precondition of living. I don't mean to trivialize or exaggerate. But in trying to understand what guns might give us, why some of us want them so badly, I turn to this: in intimacy with death, in close proximity to grieving, is where we find ourselves most alive. It is the limit that creates the event of life, that is the necessary condition for the experience of life. I propose to consider a dimension of political life that has to do with our exposure to violence and our complicity in it, with our vulnerability to loss and the task of mourning that follows, and with finding a basis for community in these conditions, writes Judith Butler in her important 2004 essay, Violence, Mourning, Politics. Butler's venture: the just community could only be one that consistently recognizes, that does not banish, vulnerability, fear, grieving, those states that in attempting to deny we only become more and more subject to. Loss and vulnerability seem to follow from our being socially constituted bodies, attached to others, at risk of losing those attachments, exposed to others, at risk of violence by virtue of that exposure, she continues, a precise description of social life, I think, though mostly we attempt to locate ourselves outside of loss, refusing exposure. Perhaps what guns seem to promise, to some, is to bring us closer, by way of the metonymic power of the object, to our actually lived vulnerability. Despite the claim that guns protect, we know that a person carrying a gun or a person with a gun in their house is far more at risk of death or injury than one who is unarmed, just as a society that is rich with guns is a society rich with risk. I don't want here to rehearse the numbers. Rather, I want to consider the position of the one who is armed. For it seems only true that if I own a gun, I not only know that I could hurt you, but I also acknowledge that you could hurt me. As much as the symbol of a gun might seem to project power, it also suggests deep vulnerability. As one senator said to me during a hearing on gun control bills, I assume everyone I meet is armed. The one who assumes this lives in fear, close to grief. I'd like to say then, perversely, that the gun and the poem share a common purpose. And that purpose is to allow us these proximities. 2. Alert and awake. Think of the mass killings in our country that have occurred in places we might consider sacred: the church, the temple, the school, the theater, the dance club. These places are not simply public. They are or were places reserved for peace and communion, heartbreakingly figured by the Emmanuel Prayer Circle in Charleston, South Carolina. In entering these spaces, we remove ourselves from the chaos and struggle associated with the street or the marketplace, as well as from the privacy of the home. This temporary shelter shared with others, often others we do not know, offers the promise of the common world that Hannah Arendt refers to as the political, for they are spaces of conversation, contemplation, imagination, and pleasure, the groundwork of critique and of action. The killings that have happened in these spaces, then, don't so much as break into this sacred space as they reveal it as already broken. They reveal to us that the losses we experience were already in place, waiting to happen. The sense of sacred space is, we now know better, an illusion. As the NRA likes to remind us, there truly is no gun-free zone. The killer we might have once thought excluded from these spaces enters them in order to show that such exclusion is a lie we've told ourselves. For the killer there is no outside, no ban, he is present, included everywhere. In this sense, the act of killing exposes the fundamental lack of borders, the failure of demarcation, not just of the individual body, but also of the so-called public sphere, which has always been marked by what it tries and fails to keep out. Maybe the increased insistence on the right to bear arms is at least in part an expression of an increased sense of boundarylessness that contemporary life has made acute. The gun, though seemingly a way to protect the limit of home or body, in fact reveals to us the zone of indistinction between public and private, between self and other, and between life and death. It is important to note that the right to carry movement is not universally popular. Rather, it is dominated by a specifically raced and gendered group, white males. See Chad Coutser's Good Guys with Guns, From Popular Sovereignty to Self-Defensive Subjectivity, for an analysis of what he calls the emergent and pernicious form of political subjectivity in the United States, one which engenders equally problematic notions of freedom, security, and sovereignty. Coutser analyzes the crisis of white masculinity in contemporary America, reading the rapid increase of right to carry and stand your ground laws as a legalization of non-state violence and as symptomatic of that crisis. The gun does not so much free its owner of this heightened vulnerability as it sharpens it, requiring or allowing the carrier to feel alert and awake at every moment. See the following advice from the website The Truth About Guns. Assuming that family safety is job one, the all-important question becomes how, when, and where might a life-threatening attack occur? The obvious answer. There is no way of knowing. The uncomfortable truth, family members and loved ones could be outside your care when an attack occurs. They could be with friends at school, shopping, eating at a restaurant, driving anywhere. Put that to one side. Where's the most likely place for a violent attack to occur when you're with your family? Again, who knows? You can't know if, when, where, or how it will get real. The easiest way to cover the spread, as it were, carry a gun whenever you're with your loved ones. At the mall, soccer games, grocery shopping, wherever and whenever you gather. But especially at home, if only for one simple reason. You spend more time with your family at home than you do in any other physical location. So if it's going to happen someplace where y'all are, the odds are it'll be at home. It's also important to note that rapists, stalkers, psycho exes, disgruntled employees, and other dangerous enemies know where to find you and your loved ones, at home. Another popular gun lover's website, Wide Open Spaces, offers 10 reasons a person might want to carry a gun. This is reason number 9. Better situational awareness. Some people say that when they carry, they are more on edge and are better aware of their surroundings. When I carry, my senses are on high alert and I tend to know more of what is going on around me. Having a gun means I have to know what is happening. Since threat is everywhere, and most of all at home, there is no moment that one should not be on high alert. The presence of the object in your pocket delivers you from your stupor. Long ago, 1800, William Wordsworth wrote of how blunted the modern mind had become, so used to stimulus it no longer cares to react, but rather sits passively in an almost savage torpor. Poetry, he wrote, has the unique capacity to stimulate the mind without the violence of so much of contemporary urban life. Leap into modernism and you can find this again, such as in I.A. Richards's Science and Poetry, 1926, where Richards argues for the labor of reading as a kind of stimulant that will draw us from the torpor of the unfocused life, delivering us to the fullest, keenest, most active, and completest kind of life. 3. distance and proximity. Revolutionary poetry may, exceptionally, have nothing at all to say about any fact that will be identified as political. Its grammar may be thoroughly opaque, and its sentences almost totally free of direct social reference. But imperatively, it must do this one thing. It must hurt and thrill a reader with an irresistible premonition of the feeling of being more fully and really alive than ever before, the feeling that is the true, unmistakable, and inalienable basis of revolutionary subjective universality. Keston Sutherland, Revolution and Really Being Alive. In what we could call here, only half-jokingly, the poetics of concealed carry, Keston Sutherland, like Wordsworth and Richards before him, calls on poetry to act on us the way the presence of the gun acts on our NRA enthusiast, to awaken us into hyperawareness, to hurt us and thrill us into greater proximity with life. But one can say, many have said, that awakening this feeling of being more alive than ever before is exactly what writing cannot do. That writing is instead a form of estrangement, that in attempting to represent experience, writing kills experience. Even when turning away from mere representation or mimesis, even when poems try instead to be experiences, some will point out that poems and all writing always fall short. Whatever the experience one might have in having a poem, the argument goes, it's always at a remove from the real, which would then have to be understood as pre-linguistic or sur-linguistic, as bodily and immediate. And yet perhaps it's precisely in that failure, in the gap between the poem and experience, that the poem matters most. I would venture that a poem can draw us nearer to our intensities, our desires, and our grief, not because it describes such feelings with accuracy, but because it does not. The gesture or attempt, the reach toward that is always falling short, is itself the moving element, which is why the single most resonant sentence about grief that I know is from Emerson writing on the death of his son, "I cannot get it nearer me." One could say that the root of social pain is this failure, but then so are the roots of social presence. To write is to approximate, to approach. The failure to arrive at truth, at representation, at pure intimacy, moves us. Effort and desire move us, as we become more aware of our longings, which is to say, our life. For the very reason that poetry fails to bring us our experiences of loss and vulnerability, it is loss and vulnerability. The unsatisfiable desire that the poem represents, that the poem is, pays tribute to the ways in which I am not and never was self-possessed, not and never will be secure, to how I am instead and forever disarmed. A 14-line poem on not giving up. 1. A freckle between her shoulder blades. 2. I keep trying to zip it. 3. Have never. 4. This system of marks, scrapes, and wounds. 5. Made palatable. 6. On stage or screen or page. 7. No, no. 8. But I want it to be some kind of healer or farmer. 9. Or else to be the wounded one. 10. To make my mother cry. 11. Desire achieves its lastingness. 12. Pity narrative. 13. Pity the body, these. 14. Astringent bright blooms. Only sheer violence is mute, said Arendt, who also posits that great speech and great action are coeval and coequal, belonging together in the realm of the political. But if reasoned speech stands opposed to violence, poetic writing stands instead against it, leaning on it the way we might lean against a wall. This is because, unlike speech, the language of the polis, poetic language, reaches toward the silence of grief, the muteness of violence. Poetic language lives in that failure, never hitting the mark. As poet Andrew Joron puts it, where language fails, poetry begins. The poetic cry, he says, is a triumph in defeat. 4. Scar. Poetry is a scar, writes Fred Moten on a number of occasions, pointing to the ways that poems tend to mark wounds, revealing the places we, as an individual or social body, are broken. Poetry miscommunicates catastrophe in unseemly festivity, he says. In his critical study in The Break, the aesthetics of the Black radical tradition, Moten writes of the moment where shriek turns speech into song. He finds one articulation of this moment in Frederick Douglass's narrative of the life, where Douglass describes in close succession the shrieking of his Aunt Hester as she is being whipped, and the reverberation of the wild songs, sung by slaves who, in Douglass's words, consult neither time nor tune. Douglass calls these songs rude and incoherent, noting that even though he could not make out their words, they filled him with sadness, moved him to tears. A disturbed and disturbing form of communication aims at that which is disturbed or disturbing in the world or in ourselves. 5. Mother. There is nothing like the abjection of self to show that all abjection is in fact recognition of the want on which any being, meaning, language, or desire is founded, Christopher wrote in 1980, anticipating Butler's description of the body as constituted precisely through its attachments, losses, and exposures. In Revolution in Poetic Language, 1977, Christopher describes this founding in want as a phase in human psychic development. She names the kora, both or neither, a time and place during which the pre-linguistic subject finds herself in a bodily, rhythmic, semiotic motility, regulated by and dependent upon the mother's body. Christopher borrows the term from Plato's Timaeus, where it describes a receptacle or space capable of transforming its character in response to whatever passes through, thus associated with the mother. The developmental version of the kora precedes the so-called mirror stage, in which the child begins to structure its identity through the symbolic order. But crucially, Christopher emphasizes that the semiotic kora is not a stage that is superseded or transcended. Rather, its status is continual, in dialectic with the symbolic. As the symbolic's precondition, it's also its twin. While Lacanian theory posits, in Christopher's words, that dependence on the mother is severed and transformed into a symbolic relation to an other, Christopher argues for the continued presence of the pre-symbolic semiotic motility, which finds its expression precisely in art, especially in poetic language. It's in poetry, most acutely for Christopher, the modernist experimentation with language and form, that we can clearly see the disruption of the symbolic at play. Breaks in normative grammar, the overt use of rhythm and sound, syntactical disturbances, and the refusal or delay of semantic meaning all constitute the semiotic in language. These are the literary devices that poets often call upon in defining their genre. But what's most distinct and to me lasting about Christopher's take is that her semiotic is first and foremost a language of the body and of its drives that are regulated through their dependence on another. Their presence in the poem, then, is the mark of abjection or dependency, which Butler posits as a foundation for justice. 6. IU. Unlike a poem whose object is absence, the missed, or the missing, violence directs itself toward a presence, a seen or, in the case of precision-guided munitions, mapped object. And though it probably goes without saying that the perpetrator of violence is in some way confused about his or her desires, in the moment of enacting violence, the positioning of subject and object, the grammar, could not be more clear. I hurt, you, subject, action, verb, object. The thetic break is Christopher's term for the linguistic structure in this relation. Any statement, which is all statements, that insists on the position of the subject as subject is thetic. The thetic phase of language acquisition establishes the speaker as a subject in relation to whom all other things and beings are objects. There can be no language without a thetic phase, 72, admits Christopher. And yet, in describing ritualized sacrifice as an extreme manifestation of the thetic, she acknowledges the violent potential lurking in all structural relations where a subject acts upon an object. The sacred sacrifice, which is found in every society, is then a theologization of the thetic, she writes in a chapter of Revolution in Poetic Language titled Poetry That Is Not a Form of Murder. And yet, as the title of that chapter indicates, Christopher argues throughout Revolution in Poetic Language that not all language is in this way violent. Poetry answers to the violent face of the thetic by offering the ontological dislocation that opposes the thetic break. Poetic mimesis is led to dissolve not only the denotative function, but also the specifically thetic function of positing the subject. Poetic mimesis manages this dissolve of the thetic precisely because it works to dismantle the clear delineation of subject and object. This blurring of boundaries between I and you, experienced in the earliest relationship between mother and infant, is what Kristeva refers to with the term jouissance. In cracking the socio-symbolic order, splitting it open, changing vocabulary, syntax, the word itself, and releasing from within them the drives borne by vocalic or kinetic difference, jouissance works its way into the social and symbolic. In contrast to sacrifice, poetry shows us that language lends itself to the penetration of the socio-symbolic by jouissance, and that the thetic does not necessarily imply theological sacrifice. Not just an idea about language, Kristeva's semiotic, symbolic oscillation allows for an identity similarly oscillating between dependence and independence, between self-presence and abjection, and because of such uncertain founding, an identity in relationship not girded only by violence. That Kristeva locates the roots of this identity in maternity does not mean she necessarily fetishizes the maternal body. Rather, as Kelly Oliver has written, Kristeva uses maternity as an example of an experience that calls into question any notion of a unified subject. Maternity becomes a prime example of what she calls a subject in process. Kristeva analyzes maternity in order to suggest that all distinctions between subjects and objects, all identifications of unified subjects, are arbitrary. Butler's theory of identity, like Kristeva's, though less obviously, also draws on the early experience of dependency on a caregiver. I may wish to reconstitute myself, as if it were there all along, a tacit ego with acumen from the start, but to do so would be to deny the various forms of rapture and subjection that form the condition of my emergence as an individuated being, and that continue to haunt my adult sense of self with whatever anxiety and longing I may now feel. At one level, this situation is literally familiar, she writes. Pressing beyond the realm of psychic development, and not considering, as Kristeva does, ways in which this model of selfhood finds expression in language, as the war on terror begins to define American life and life far beyond our borders, Butler asks us to resist the self-defensive subjectivity that she sees quite literally marching down the avenues. Much more recently, in a conversation with Sarah Ahmed, she rearticulates the central question of the earlier essay. What if we shift the question from who do I want to be, to the question, what kind of life do I want to live with others? It seems to me that then many of the questions, about happiness, but perhaps also about the good life, very ancient yet urgent philosophical question, take shape in a new way. If the I who wants this name or seeks to live a certain kind of life is bound up with a you and a they, then we are already involved in a social struggle when we ask how best any of us are to live. Kristeva too suggests the political potential of this recognition or rapture, jouissance, writing that only when the semiotic is present to disrupt symbolic signification and the division between subject and object that the symbolic expresses and enforces, only then does the signification process join social revolution. It seems clear that the turn away from emotional expression in poetry that with the advent of conceptual poetry made such headlines a few years ago, and what transformative years they have been, but which can be found in the digital poem's interest in pattern and process, and traced to some of language poetry's rejection of subjective expression, was when most sincere, actually an attempt to turn from destructive and potentially violent ideologies of subjectivity. Wanting the poem to belong to a collective, or to reflect social realities rather than individual ones, a poet or critic might valorize supposedly desubjectivizing strategies, such as collage, appropriation, procedural, or documentary poetics, though all of these strategies can be mobilized for other reasons as well. Wanting to escape what seems like the bind of the ego in order to comment on culture more broadly, a poet might also stridently avoid material too close to home, too burdened by feeling. However, as such, the arguments against expression represent a failure to recognize what other models of identity might be at work in poems that highlight or generate emotion. These arguments against expression hinge on what I consider to be a patriarchal concept of self and a limited idea of the political work emotion can do. If selfhood is in fact a shared entity, a vector made and remade through its encounters, then its emotions are shared as well. And this means quite simply that the emotional experiences we might discover in reading poems or might find in making them are not private. They do not belong to their author like some abstract form of property she's trying to protect or sell. This does not, however, make emotions less valuable, less powerful, or less important. Rather, it makes them more so. The social source and aim of emotion is its agency, its politics, and its engagement. This is why emotion in poetry matters, not because it's mine but because it's ours. 7. No longer alone. While gun ownership might in fact reach toward a distorted version of the vulnerability that Butler and Kristeva theorize as central to the building of something we could call, without shame, community, the gun carrier's sense of that vulnerability requires not that he mourn, the crucial second term in Butler's essay title, but that he redraw the boundaries of his corporeal self, his family, or perhaps his social group. The carrier projects his losses, but among them is not the autonomy of the body itself. There is no such thing as the human, writes Athanasiou. Instead, there is only the dizzying multiplicity of the cut human, the human body as interminably cut, fractured. In the clefts of history and at the limits of representation, the cut body of humanity tells the story of the indeterminability that haunts the dreams and nightmares of the fully there. Therefore, despite what I read as the gun carrier's desire, shared with the poet, to be awakened into increased aliveness and charged affective attachment to others, the self-defensive subject, Kautzer's term in insisting on being fully there, reaffirms the thetic. And if, rather than performing the decisive grammar of the thetic from the position of subject, the gun owner finds, as often happens, the bullet returned to his own body, then he will discover finally how bidirectional thetic violence truly is. But the problem for the poet, a problem shared by anyone who seeks to create what Athanasio calls a haptic technology, a generator of empathy, is how to deny our protections, how to stand exposed when difference and separation seem to mark the human body, in a society stratified and marked by group conflict, where the threat of exposure seems to open us to the unbearable. For the most vulnerable people in our culture, those who are quite literally attacked, and today I am thinking of the trans woman, the black male, the poor, though now in Trump's America there are so many targets, the question seems almost perverse. The problem then remains, writes Athanasiou, how to think representation, cultural, political, textual, without the ontological presuppositions of authoritarian self-presence, how to think the body beyond the ontic, beyond the representational presuppositions of the birth to presence, how to think the political beyond sovereignty, and finally, how to think the language of the political beyond denomination. Poetic language, when most activated, thinks through these questions by way of threading shriek into word, cry into articulation. A poem will not stop a bullet, but it might in this way answer it, not heal a loss but draw attention to the losses we carry. As Nathaniel Mackey has written, poetry, if not exactly a loser's art, is fed by an intimacy with loss and may in fact feed it. When the book met the bullet, it met the thing it was after, and the thing that was after it, not its own death but its own life, made palpable through and in the broken face that was now its cover. Notes. The Witch's House. A Poetics. And There Is No Place on Earth for the Mother. Kaya Silverman. Sometimes when people write a poetics, they begin by talking about war. Ron Silliman's The New Sentence begins that way. Williams's Introduction to the Wedge. A war is hiding within Wordsworth's preface to lyrical ballads. A war stands behind.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.